I now can sing since I've been redeemed.
I'm on the everlasting rock.
I faith in Christ, my Redeemer King.
I'm on the everlasting rock. Then roll, roll, billows roll. I'm on the everlasting rock of ages. Roll, roll, billows roll. I'm on the everlasting rock.
Welcome to the Voice of Hope. Whether you've been reading the Bible for a long time or just opening its pages for the first time, we're here to explore and learn together. At the Voice of Hope, we provide clear and simple Bible teaching. Join us as we dive into God's Word and learn what it means to follow Jesus.
Let all things now live in a song of thanksgiving to God the Creator, triumphantly raised, who fashioned and made us, protected and stayed us, who still guides us on to the end of our days.
This program is produced by Heralds of Hope. We're an international ministry, and our vision is to use media to make disciples of Jesus Christ and accomplish the Great Commission in our lifetime. We do this by creating Bible teaching and distributing Bibles around the world. One of our partners from Sierra Leone shared his thanks for the recent arrival of a container load of 18,000 Bibles. He said, "I'm here to say my profound thanks. We have just received and offloaded the container of 18,000 copies of the Bible. They will go across the country to many trainers and churches. The need for scriptures in Sierra Leone is very great. As the church continues to grow, so does the need for the scripture. Our sincere appreciation to Heralds of Hope and the many brethren who have come alongside to make these Bibles available to the believers in Sierra Leone. Thank you for coming alongside of us." That's the end of his quote. Thank you for your support as we work together to take the Word of God to believers far and wide. Today, I'm here with our Bible teacher, J. Mark Horst, to continue our study in the Gospel of Mark. Join us as we begin our study.
Do you know the secret to a lasting marriage? I'm sure there are as many answers as there are opinions, and some will be right. Some people would say that love is the most critical component. Do you agree with that? I don't, and I'll tell you why in a few minutes. In Greek mythology, sirens were beautiful sea nymphs who lured sailors off their intended course with their beauty and with their enchanting songs. Many sailors who succumbed to their charms ran their ships aground on the Sirens' Island and they were never heard from again. That island was littered with the wreckage of ships, broken and bleached bones, and rotting corpses. In Homer's epic poem, The Odyssey, Odysseus had his sailors fasten his body with cords securely to the ship's mast before he sailed by this island. And he did that because he was fearful he would not be able to resist the siren song of this beguiling place. So as his ship passed by the enchanted island, Odysseus was struggling mightily to break the ropes that held him to the mast. He begged his sailors to untie him, regardless of the consequences. But you know, his sailors were wiser than he was, and they refused to obey his order. They had all plugged their ears with wax to shut out the siren's song. So eventually, the ship escaped danger, passed by the island, and after that, his men released him. He had avoided a catastrophic temptation that would have destroyed his boat, his crew, his home, his wife, and his family. You know, this is a dramatic example of one man's effort to protect himself and his future from a momentary, foolhardy decision. One of the core functions of the church and the culture at large is to build institutions and norms and traditions that help protect us from the various siren songs that are all around us in our time. Marriage is one of those institutions. God designed it to constrain your future actions so that you can make long-term plans for the benefit of others. That's your wife and children, without them worrying about you running off to any siren song that you hear. Marriage, as it was designed by God, requires total commitment, and I believe that is the most critical component. When we enter the marriage covenant, we commit to each other 100%. Our vows include our promise to love and care for each other in sickness and in health, in poverty and wealth, through the successes and reverses of life, until finally, death is what separates us. We promise an unequivocal, I do. In today's study, we're looking at the opening verses of Mark chapter 10, where the Pharisees confront Jesus with a question relating to marriage. And as we'll see, their commitment to marriage was, maybe I do. So I've taken that title for my teaching, maybe I do. I invite you to listen carefully now as I read the text, Mark chapter 10, verses 1 to 12. This is God's unchanging word. Then he arose from there and came to the region of Judea by the other side of the Jordan. And multitudes gathered to him again, and as he was accustomed, he taught them again. The Pharisees came and asked him, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" testing him. And he answered and said to them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and to dismiss her." And Jesus answered and said to them, "Because of the hardness of your heart, he wrote you this precept. But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then, they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate." In the house, his disciples also asked him again about the same matter. So he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if a woman divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." You know, too many times when we read Scripture, we isolate it from its larger context. And as I've said before, that can lead to errors of interpretation and application. And this text that I just read is a clear example. If you were with me for the two previous episodes from Mark chapter 9, we looked at kingdom values followed by radical discipleship. I encourage you to visit our website if you haven't listened to or read those episodes. Our website is www.heraldsofhope.org. Just briefly, the kingdom values we looked at in Mark chapter 9 and verses 30 to 41 were anonymity, humility, and inclusivity. And the concepts of radical discipleship in Mark 9, 42 to 50 were radical love, radical purity, and radical obedience. These are the larger contexts for our study today. In this dialogue with the Pharisees and his disciples, Jesus highlights the insufficiency of the maybe I do mentality, and he calls us to a radical commitment to his plan and his purpose for marriage. First of all, Mark highlights the confrontation. At the end of Mark chapter 9, it's approximately 6 months until Jesus will go to the cross. In Mark chapter 10, it's only a few weeks until that event. One-third of Luke's gospel fits between these two chapters, between the end of Mark chapter 9 and the beginning of Mark chapter 10. Jesus is making his final journey to Jerusalem, and the multitudes around him were most likely heading toward Jerusalem for the Passover as well. Now, our text points out that Jesus was traveling through Perea. You know, sometimes when we read the scriptures, we think, what does that matter? Why do we need to know that? But God doesn't waste words and he doesn't waste ink. Everything he inspired the biblical writers to write has a purpose. And so this little detail of Jesus traveling through Perea is important. Why? Because this area was ruled by Herod. And the Pharisees here confronted Jesus with their divorce question. Now we know that their motives were not honorable. They were trying to trap Jesus. They wanted to use his answer to make him look bad in the eyes of the people and the other religious leaders. It's also possible that they hoped Jesus' stance on divorce would provide a similar outcome to that of John the Baptist at the hands of Herodias. The Pharisees' intent seems to have been to force Jesus to choose sides in the debate between the rabbinical schools about what were permissible grounds for divorce. One faction was led by Rabbi Hillel, and he was embraced by the Pharisees. That's why, in Matthew 19:3, they ask Jesus this question, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason?" Hillel permitted divorce for trivial reasons, even things as ludicrous as burning the meal. The other school of thought was led by Rabbi Shammai. And he taught that divorce was only allowed in cases of extramarital sexual activity. Evidently, the students of Hillel had the mistaken idea that many people have today, and that is that God designed marriage to make us happy. You know something? I don't find that teaching anywhere in the scriptures. What I do see is that God designed marriage to make us holy and to glorify Him. Now, that isn't to say that marriage has no happiness. It does. And the scriptures talk about that. And I've experienced it. But happiness is not the primary purpose for marriage. Anyone who enters into marriage with happiness as their primary goal is destined to fail. God takes two different individuals with very different personalities, different giftings, temperaments, and intellects, and he commands them to become one. He actually joins them together and makes it possible, but it's hard work. Marriage will not fulfill God's purposes without radical love, radical purity, and radical obedience to Jesus Christ, as we learned in our previous teaching episode. So if the primary goal of your marriage is happiness, you will ask the same question eventually that the Pharisees ask. Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Well, as he so often did, Jesus used the standard teaching tool of that time. He asked them a question in response. What did Moses command you to do? Jesus took them back to the Mosaic law to which they claimed unquestioning fealty. But here's the question. Was Moses' directive really a command? Notice how they answered Jesus. He had said, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses permitted a man to write a bill of divorce and dismiss her." They were, of course, referring to Deuteronomy chapter 24 and verses 1 to 4. The bill of divorce or document is called biblion, and it means little book. The Latin is libellus, from which comes our English word libel. And a libel is a written statement in which a plaintiff sets forth the cause of action or the relief that they're seeking. Wycliffe translates this phrase as a libel of forsaking. And then the word divorce. In the original, it's apostasion. Synonyms are defection and desertion, like a slave from his master. In today's language, it means a falling out of love. And as you might have guessed, this word is related to apostasia, our English word apostasy, a falling away or desertion from the faith. I contend that divorce is a form of apostasy. It's a falling away from one's marriage partner and a falling away from God and His Word. As we will see, these words bear heavily on Jesus' teaching on this subject. So this is the confrontation. Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? So then, Mark goes on, through Jesus, to highlight the concession. Now, a concession is something that we agree to, usually grudgingly, to reach an agreement or to improve a situation. And that is precisely what the law of Moses did. It was a concession. Divorce was never God's intention. And Jesus' explanation of this begins in verse 5. He told them, "Because of the hardness of your heart, Moses wrote you this precept." The hardness of heart is sclerocardia. Did you catch the connection to our English word arteriosclerosis, or hardening of the arteries? The hard-heartedness of these people was the disease, and a certificate of divorce was the prescription. And like many prescriptions today, it reduced the symptoms, but it didn't cure the underlying disease. Now, how serious is hardness of heart? Will God overlook, sanction, or save those who possess hard hearts? Will anyone with a hard heart be in heaven? I think to ask the question is to answer it. And so Jesus' pronouncement that the Mosaic provision pertained to hard hearts underscores that it was not intended as a divine sanction of divorce. You know, Paul wrote about this hardness of heart in Romans 2:5. He said, "But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath, when God's righteous judgment will be revealed." The only remedy for a hard heart is genuine repentance. Moses' law was not a command. It was a concession. The law neither commanded divorce nor established divorce as a right. It was illegal, but like many laws today, it was not necessarily moral. God allowed divorce, but He didn't command it or sanction it. As I understand it, the prescription in Deuteronomy chapter 24 was for the woman's protection. If this Old Testament passage would have provided a suitable answer to the Pharisees' question, Jesus undoubtedly would have referred to it. Instead, His response to their argument demonstrates that this passage does not provide the proper answer to their question concerning the propriety of divorce. He discounted the passage by offering a rebuttal to its applicability to their question. The prescription did, however, offer some protection for women. The certificate of divorce protects the divorced wife from false allegations of adultery from her ex-husband or other people. The rules on remarriage also prohibited the former husband from treating his wife as disposable property. Once she remarried, she was lost to him forever. He could not try to reclaim her after another man married her. It's also likely that the divorce certificate specified the property rights of the ex-wife so that she wouldn't be left destitute after the divorce. You know, God's protection for the rights of women were revolutionary at the time. So this certificate of divorce was the concession God granted to His people. Why? Because of their hard-heartedness. And many today still try to grasp it. The final highlight, then, that Jesus gives is the clarification. In verses 6 to 12 of our text, Jesus returns to God's design and purpose for marriage from the creation. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 24, "For this cause" did not refer to God making the first human beings male and female, but rather to God's making Eve out of Adam's side. Since the woman came from the man should unite with the woman to recapture their original unity. It takes both male and female to represent God and His attributes accurately. When he's discussing male leadership in 1 Corinthians 11, Paul writes these words, "For this reason, the woman ought to have authority on her head, because of the angels. Nevertheless, neither is the man independent of the woman, nor woman independent of the man in the Lord. For as the woman came from man, even so man also comes through the woman. But all things are from God." The point is that neither man nor woman are independent of each other. They are mutually dependent on God and on each other. The man is commanded to leave behind his father and his mother, those who are closest to him in flesh and blood, and he forms a new union and a new family unit by cleaving to his wife. The word cleave means to glue, to bond, or adhere, and it creates an unbreakable bond. You know, I've worked with wood for many years, and I've glued many pieces together. When those pieces of wood are correctly prepared, and the glue is properly applied and cured, the joint will rarely fail. That's the picture of what it means to cleave to each other as husband and wife. Sometimes, when I wasn't sure if the glue that I was using was too old, or maybe it had gotten too cold, or something like that, and had lost its effectiveness, I'd test it. I'd glue pieces of scrap wood together, and then once the joint was cured, I'd try to break it apart. If the glue was good, the wood fibers would break and tear, but the joint would remain solid. Any attempted separation of the marriage unit will bring tremendous damage to the relationships and the individuals who are involved. That cracking and tearing does great damage, and it leaves lifelong scars. Some of you can testify to that. Jesus said that leaving and cleaving would result in two becoming one flesh. The Shema from Deuteronomy 6:4 states, "Hear, O Israel, Yahweh, our God, is one." Echad is the Hebrew word for one, but more precisely, it means a single entity comprising more than one part. So that allows for the triunity of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They have separate roles and titles, but they are one. There is no division or separation between them. They agree entirely. Echad also describes the reality of a man and woman becoming one, one flesh. According to Ephesians 5:32, the unity of their marriage is to mirror the unity of Christ and the church. Now, I would quickly add this, that this oneness doesn't detract from or nullify individuality or personality. We are different. That's a given. But instead, each one's uniqueness is designed and directed for the good of the whole. Now, as a result of this oneness, which God designed, Jesus said, "That which God has yoked together, let not man divide." In other words, human beings have no right to divide what God has joined. Sadly, today, many marriage counselors and many pastors have been guilty of violating this command. They have allowed their emotions and personal preferences to override the clear teaching of Scripture. Eventually, they will give an account before God of what they've done. You see, the Pharisees, like many today, treated marriage too lightly. Marriage isn't a business contract. It can't be revoked if one party fails to live up to their obligations. Marriage is an exclusive heterosexual covenant between one man and one woman, ordained and sealed by God. Have you ever wondered why, at a wedding, the bride's family and friends sit across the aisle from the groom's family and friends? Why does the couple walk down the aisle between those two groups of people after they have taken their wedding vows? Are those things just tradition, or do they have a deeper meaning? If you know anything about biblical covenants, they involved cutting. The root of the Hebrew word for covenant comes from the word to cut. Now, this may offend our modern sensibilities, but in an Old Testament covenant, animals were killed, they were cut in half, and then the pieces were placed so that the parties of the covenant walked between them. Walking between the animal parts together said, "If I don't keep my end of this covenant, let me be cut in two like these animals." And ancient documents clearly spell out this gruesome meaning in graphic detail. So making a covenant like this wasn't just something that godly people did, but it was used by pagans as well. As I said, marriage is a covenant, and I believe the traditional seating practices and the recessional indicate that connection. Every person attending the wedding becomes a witness to the marriage covenant and should be interested in seeing that that covenant remains unbroken. So then, after the crowds were gone and the 12 were alone with Jesus, they brought up the issue again. And Jesus responded to them this way: "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if a woman divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." Jesus gives no exceptions. And that's where we'll have to end for today, because we're out of time. Be sure to join me next week as we pick up the remainder of this teaching.
Thank you, J. Mark, for teaching us once again from the Gospel of Mark. I hope you were blessed as you listened to today's program. Thank you for listening. If you would like to hear this program again, please visit our website at heraldsofhope.org. Our email address is hope@heraldsofhope.org. I invite you to subscribe to our channels on the various social media platforms, including YouTube, Spotify, and Telegram, by searching for Heralds of Hope. To contact the Voice of Hope or to send us a gift, call us at 866-960-0292, or you can mail it to the Voice of Hope, 6183 Lincoln Highway, Harrisonville, Pennsylvania, 17228, or visit our website at heraldsofhope.org. Your prayers are needed, and your gifts are always welcome. God's grace, accompanied by your fervent prayers, will enable us to work together to win the world for Jesus. Be sure to join us the next time for the Voice of Hope.